fellow Journey fans. How's everyone doing? Mark Ricche here. Have a very special guest to share with you today. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. David Hamilton Golland, author of the upcoming book on Journey entitled Livin Just to Find Emotion, Journey and Race in Rock Music. Now, I've read this book, and let me tell you, it is an academically researched exploration of the history of the band as much as it is a story about the resegregation of popular music as told through the lens of the entity that we now know as Journey. Now, for those of you that are familiar with Journey Dave, you're probably aware that he is already a published author with two books in circulation, one, Constructing Affirmative Action, The Struggle for Equal Employment Opportunity, as well as the book entitled A Terrible Thing to Waste, Arthur Fletcher and the Conundrum of the Black Republican. And he's also serves as the editor for the Arthur Fletcher Papers, which is like a 250,000-page collection of personal and organizational documents, all centered around the father of affirmative action enforcement. David holds a Ph.D. from the University of New York, an MA from the University of Virginia, and he is currently actually the dean of the Wayne D. McMurray School of Humanities and Social Sciences, as well as a professor of history at Monmouth University. Point being, if there is a man to speak on race in rock music, it is David. Now, most of you Journey fans know him as the mastermind behind the Journey's own website, which has been in existence since late 2000. And David makes dozens of public appearances throughout the year, ranging from plenary talks to panel paper discussions. He's appeared on radio talk shows, C-SPAN's American History TV, but he's here today to speak with us exclusively about his upcoming book, the release of Journey, Livin' Just to Find Emotion, Race in Rock Music. And ladies and gentlemen, let's get started. David, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks so much, Mark. Thank you.
No, I'm so glad you're here. I want to thank you for an early copy of the book and had a chance to go through it, have a ton of questions for you. So let's go ahead and dive right in, if we may. Let me see here. The first question that I have is, the story of the rock band Journey can kind of be told from so many angles. Having been entrenched in the story myself while working on the musical, it could be defined as sort of a rags to riches story. During the Perry era, it kind of follows Joseph Campbell's sort of hero's journey, all the steps. And yet you kind of chose to focus this on race in rock music, which I found very interesting because one of the struggles that I'm coming across while working on the musical is, hey, in a time when Broadway is really trying to broaden its horizons for those underrepresented, you come to us with a story about a bunch of white guys. For that reason, I really kind of locked on to the message in the book and thought, oh, wow, there might be something in here that I could use. Talk about how you came to that decision, because again, you could have come at it from any angle.
Absolutely. Thank you for the question. And first, let me say, you mentioned that I've given you an early copy of the book. I think when you did that, you just made dozens and dozens of people really, really jealous. I keep getting lots and lots of requests via Twitter, via email, other social media. Hey, when can we see the book? When is it going to be published? Is it going to be on Amazon? I mean, the answer is, of course, yes. Every book under the sun is going to be on Amazon. Of course, I'm hoping to get it into some of the actual brick and mortar retailers as well. And that'll depend on the publisher. And I know you have a question later on in our repertoire this afternoon that has to do with when it'll be published. But there's a number of people who are just going, oh, man, I wish I was Mark Ricche today. I wish I had already read this book. So why race? I guess for that one, so we have to kind of look back to the origins of my decision to go forward with a book project. And so I am a a historian and a scholar of race. My first books, academic books, published by university presses were on civil rights history, African American history, and my most recent book was the biography of an African American Republican named Arthur Fletcher, published in 29 by the University Press of Kansas. And so that is very much the prism through which I look at history. But that's not how I initially approached this project. This, I called it my pandemic project. It was the winter of 2020 to 2021. And I'm sure our viewers can look back at that time in their lives and think about how difficult those particular months were. Unlike in the previous summer, it was a lot harder to go out. You had to stay in. And I myself was having concerns about where the direction that I wanted to go in terms of my scholarship, in terms of my professional life. And I came across a book gosh, I hope he doesn't sue me for saying so, but it really, really wasn't good. And this is Neil Daniels' History of Journey. What is he? I can't even, I'm blocking on the name, but it came out in 2011. And he is a British journalist, and every page had an error. I may be over exaggerating here. Now I'm worried that he's going to sue me, so I have to be very careful with what I say. But buy the book, everyone. You should absolutely buy the book. It is a good sort of basic history of journey, but from my perspective, it was bad because there were so many errors. And because of two other reasons. And the first is that it seemed like it took sides. It seemed to be taking the side of one of the musicians against other musicians in all of the many internecine conflicts that were taking place in the band throughout the history of the band. And that's never a good way to go, whether you're a journalist or a historian like I am. And the other reason is that there were a number of missed opportunities. So I'm probably over exaggerating here as well, but I would say every five or six pages, the author would say something, I would be reading something, and I would go, okay, tell me more. Okay, follow that rabbit hole. Just give me two more paragraphs about that particular story. I'm so eager to hear it. And it wasn't there. And then we're moving on to the next tour or the next album. So all the facts are in there. That's why I say, by all means, Journey fans should buy that book. I'm not just saying that so he doesn't sue me. Buy that book because it is, again, a very good, brief, basic history of the band, as long as you understand that there could be some bias there and you should be aware of it as a reader. But I found myself increasingly frustrated by it because I'm a professional historian. And when I look at the past and I write about the past, it's based on, well, as you know, Mark, I mean, it's based on, I would say, a week of research for every day of writing. It's based on visits to archives. It's based on copious readings of what we in history call primary and secondary sources. That is, sources that were written or produced in the case of music or video or interviews and the like at the original time of the history that they're talking about. And secondary sources in the sense of things that were written after the fact or significantly after the fact. For instance, books about something that happened a decade ago or four decades ago, or now with Journey five, 6 decades ago, when you talk even about pre-Journey history and the origins of the original band members. And I bring that professionalism to my craft and I take it very seriously. And it's why the two books that I've already written, as well as books by every PhD historian I can think of, have footnotes, which are actually converted into endnotes with publication. So citations that every single sentence, every single statement of fact tells the discerning reader where the author came up with that idea, that he or she didn't just pull it out of whole cloth. And I thought to myself, well, why don't I write the history of Journey? And then I asked myself, well, who the heck am I? I'm not a former member of the band. I'm not a former manager of the band. I wasn't a drum tech. I didn't pick up their garbage after they left the hotel. I'm a longtime fan of the band, but who the heck am I to do this? And of course, I am more than a fan of the band, as you know, Mark, and as I think most of our viewers will know, I am the founding and longtime publisher of The Journey Zone, which evolved out of a fan tribute website in the late 90s called journeydave.com. And I was Journey Dave, and I had a license plate that said that was JRNYDV. And I drove around in between plates with that hashtag, I guess you could say now. We didn't use hashtags back. We didn't call them hashtags back then. And that morphed into a more professional, I'm not a journalist, but a journalistic style of a website that kind of wanted to cover all things Journey and all things related to Journey. And even for fun, from time to time, we'd throw in some interesting stuff. You could find, for Pete's sake, you could find a review of a orchestra performance by the American Soviet or the American Russian Young Artists Orchestra from like 2003 is in there just because it was fun, you know. But you know, things like what is the connection between Santana and Journey? Or I got the exclusive interview with Robert Fleischman, Journey's first frontman, who preceded Steve Perry. So I asked myself, who the heck am I to write this book about Journey? Oh, I mean, I'm Journey Dave. I'm the guy who has the Journey Zone. Even though for much of the past 15 years or so, I haven't put a lot of effort into that endeavor, it's still up there and I still do edit it. And I still do have a team of editors that work on the website from time to time. We're not always quite up to date. So that's that was kind of how I answered the question. Why don't I write the history of Journey from a standpoint of professional history writing and also being that guy who had the Journey Zone website, right? I figured, okay, I could probably get this published. I could probably get an agent, which you have to do with when you're not publishing an academic academic book. In the past, I didn't have an agent, because I went with university presses. So I've said I could probably get an agent based on this, and I could probably get an editor to agree to publish this with a trade press. And then I got to work at it and, started doing the research. And as vaccines came around and as a lot of our COVID cloud lifted, I was able to actually do some work in archives. For instance, I went to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame archives, which are located in Cuyahoga Community College in Cleveland, just down the road from the Hall of Fame itself. And that was neat because all the archivists have passes and they got me in to see the museum, you know, also highly recommended. And as I went through the project, my background as a race historian, as a race scholar, started to, I guess you could say, tickle the way I was feeling the project.
Percolate, yeah.
It started to percolate, and I started to see things through that prism that I had long trained myself to see things. And there's a reason today why people on the left, progressives, use the word woke to talk about people who have come to realize the continuing prevalence of racism in our society. When you study race, you wake up to the racism around you and the role of race. I apologize. When you are a white person studying race, you wake up. The fact is, African Americans do not need to wake up because they are living race all the time, because the majority of the population is always looking at African Americans through a racial prism, even though they don't necessarily realize they're doing so, right? So the more I got into it, the more I started seeing the role of race. And in history and in scholarship and in race scholarship in particular, in recent decades, there has been a trend towards an area called whiteness studies. And whiteness studies is not white supremacy studies necessarily. And neither is it African American studies. It is a way of understanding the creation, if you will, of what it is to be white in our society, or the creation of whiteness. And this is come to by scholars who are, for lack of a better term, woke. Right. Hmm. So whiteness studies is not about championing whiteness. It's about understanding why people think they're white, why people call themselves white, how does society define white, and why that is actually problematic, because white is always in the Western world defined as superior in some way, and that needs to be broken down. And so whiteness studies, it's kind of like studying race, but looking specifically at white people and how they have crafted, largely unconsciously, but in many cases consciously, crafted their sense of racial identity. And it includes the study of white privilege, et cetera, et cetera. And as I'm looking at Journey, I can't help but notice who's in the crowd. There is, for instance, footage on YouTube now available of a show they did, I think, it's either in Passaic or Paterson, New Jersey, two cities that I always mix up in northern New Jersey because they both begin with a P, and they're both Rust Belt towns, basically, old industrial towns that today have inner cores, right, what other people might call a ghetto. But in the 70s, these were fourth and fifth generation working class families living there. And who is at these shows where in 1978, Greg Raleigh is shaking his satin covered hips, standing on his organ, while Steve Perry is waving scarves, and holding on to that microphone stand? Who are those men in the front row slamming their palms down on the front of the stage, demanding that fourth encore, by the way, for this band? They're all white. And I said to myself, well, gosh, I should have noticed that before, because we also have to notice our own in whiteness studies. If we are white, we have to notice our own, the fleck in your own eye, as they would say in the Bible, and my own issues. And I thought, well, of course, why didn't I notice this before? And being white and growing up as a Journey fan, I was blind to this. And now I see, really. So why on earth is that? I asked myself. And then I started listening to the music differently. I started appreciating the music less as a fan, which I continue to do. And, it comes on the radio and I sing along and I love it. And it's in the rotation on my MP3 player. But more as an analyst and asking, where are the roots of this music? And for Steve Perry, that's easy and that's obvious. The roots are Sam Cooke and Motown, and he's been saying that since day one. And the only song from their lost session of the King Biscuit Flower Hour that made it onto a Journey recording is a Sam Cooke song, Good Times, that made it onto the Time Cubed box set in 1992, I want to say. But it's more than Steve Perry. I realized, I keep talking about how I've always known how they keep talking about how their origins were in Santana. Manager Herbie Herbert, lead guitarist Neil Sean, organist and original lead vocalist Greg Raleigh come out of Santana. What is Santana? Santana is integrated Afro-Cuban rock music. Well, how is it possible that you have integrated Afro-Cuban rock music with congas on the stage in 1969 at Woodstock, and yet in 1978, some of the people who are on that stage or off that stage are performing in front of only white audiences, or 99% white audiences, right? How does that transition take place? And I asked myself, who else is in this band making this music? In the 2020 lawsuit, they claimed he had nothing to do with the making of the music, but that's wrong. Ross Valerie, where does he come from musically? He comes out of Steve Miller. Where does Steve Miller come from musically? He comes out of the blues. What are the blues? The blues are an African-American musical form from the early 20th century that were then adapted and became integrated, and at one point became almost seemingly almost exclusively British. But I think Steve Miller is Texan. I think that's the origins of his blues. And he and Ross Valerie are basically friends from their own late childhood, from the mid 1960s. So as I kept looking at that, this thesis began to emerge. So in the end, although I do have an agent for this particular book, if we don't land with a trade press, I have an academic thesis that will make this fit just fine with a university press. And so at this point, it's a little bit up in the air. If we land a trade press and the editors say, oh, Golland, we don't need this whole race argument. Let's just tell the history of Journey by the publisher of the Journey Zone, who also happens to be a professional PhD historian. Okay, that's great. We change the title and we move forward. And you don't have to actually change the book, because I could still talk about race. And you've read it. It's not like race is on every single page of the book, right? Journey is on every single page of the book. Race keeps coming up, and it can still keep coming up in the story. That's okay. Or if we go in an academic direction and we publish with a university press, then that becomes the thesis of the book. But that also, anyone can buy it. It's not like you have to be a scholar to buy a book published by a university press. So that's kind of where the whole race argument came from. In a professorial response, you asked like a 1 minute question, and I gave you probably a 12 minute answer.
No, you know, when I listen to interviews, that excites me. Nothing worse than an interviewer keep wants to break in, and I'm like, let him finish. He was on a roll, you know. So no, absolutely, because all of that is valuable, and there are some anecdotes in there that in the manner in which you just delivered them clarify perhaps some of the questions that I had when I was reading. You know, something that crossed my mind while you were talking was when Neil Schon approached the band at the time, would have been Kane, I assume, specifically, and said, found this guy online, or was it Jonathan that found Arnell?
No, it was Neil.
I remember him telling John, I'm a little nervous. He's Filipino. How is our fan base going to react to that? So even Neil recognized that they are dealing with a pizza and beer white crowd, you know?
Yes.
Let's go ahead and move on. And you may have already answered this question. And technically you have. You started the Journey Zone back in the early 2000s. It was at the time of the genesis of the internet. So you kind of captured lightning in a bottle.
Five, 6 years after, but okay.
roughly. I didn't start using it till the early 2000s. Yeah. A lot of my students were using it way before then, but you had this website and so forth. And I do have to ask, because and you may have already answered this in your previous comments, why Journey? And what I mean by that is, why not any other band? Because anybody who was starting a website in the early 2000s, I always kind of get suspicious. Like, because that's when everybody was buying up domains and stuff. And they still are, you know, buy the domain and squat on it. And let's, you know, hope that somebody either buys it or maybe I'll develop it. So, you know, what was your intent behind creating the Journey Zone website? Was it merely, hey, look, I'm a fan. I'm a huge fan. I got the license plate on the car, and and I'm the guy who needs to be online bringing the Journey world together. You know, so my question then being, why Journey? Why not Whitesnake? Why not Motley Crue, you know, and so on and so on. Why not Springsteen and so on?
It's only years later that I found out that Ainsley Dunbar was a sometime drummer for Whitesnake, but otherwise Coverdale, I never really followed Whitesnake. Journey, I was always a fan of Journey, and I like so many, you know, it's like our parents' generation, you ask them where they were when they heard that Kennedy had been killed. Our generation, or at least some of us, Journey fans, maybe, you ask us where we were when we first heard Don't Stop Believin', and we can tell you. I mean, in my case, I was in an old Dirty Dancing style resort, much lower level than Dirty Dancing. We were not wealthy folks. I was the son of a teacher. I still am the son of a teacher. And so we were at this sort of lower level Dirty Dancing style resort in the Catskills. And I was down in the game room shooting pool at age 10. And someone put a dime in the jukebox. I think it was still a dime. At least Joan Jett claims it was still a dime. And put on Don't Stop Believin'. And I heard that song, and there was just something about it. Now, as you read the book, you can see my analysis of what that is. And I'm not analyzing my own understanding. I analyze what Steve Perry has said, and what Jonathan Cain has said, and what Neil Schon has said, and what Ross Valerie and Steve Smith have said. And and also some of the factors in their lives beyond what they say and understand about themselves and as songwriters and what they knew that they were putting into, sort of some of the things that had affected their subconscious that affected, in my opinion and in demonstrable opinion, how that song came to be. But for me, it was transcendent. Absolutely. And I wanted to hear it again. And now I don't know, I've heard it probably hundreds of thousands, if not millions of times. And it's, I enjoy it every single time. So, by the late 90s, I still was young enough to have a voice. I remember regretting that they didn't ask me when they hired Steve Augeri. They should have hired me. I had been an off-Broadway singer, you know, owned a little theater company, as you know, at the time. But that was not the path that I was on, and that's fine. But, you know, I wanted to get to know other Journey fans and take advantage of the internet that way. I wanted to also have some questions answered. And this seemed like a good way to get that to happen. So I was able to find some of the bigger, better known interviews that they had given on the web by that point. But then I was able to use the site to go and ask those questions myself. Again, Robert Fleischman, for instance, that was kind of my biggest get, but I got Greg Raleigh, you know, in that era. I arranged with his management in advance. I brought a team and we went up to Connecticut for one of his concerts. And after the show, we told the management who we were and they said, here he is. And we sat down and we recorded an interview with him and it was fantastic, you know, and I was able to ask him some of the questions that I wanted to ask him at that time. So thank you. The Journey Zone would not be what it is, would not have been what it was without the hard work of every single one of all of you. And every mistake that's on there is my fault, and everything to benefit it is thanks to you.